Hello, Dr. Greyson. Thank you for taking the time. I'd like to very briefly introduce you to our viewers. You are Professor Emeritus of Psychiatry and Neurobehavioral Sciences at the University of Virginia School of Medicine.
Right.
You were a co-founder and president of IANDS, the International Association for Near-Death Studies, and editor of the Journal of Near-Death Studies.
Yes.
And I read it's the only scientific journal which is dedicated to near-death studies.
Right.
Yeah. You were also the former director of the Division of Perceptual Studies at UVA, and you held many senior teaching and academic posts in clinical psychiatry.
Yes.
So I can't possibly do justice to your long career and all your achievements, but I think it's fair to say that you're one of the leading scientists worldwide in the field of near-death research.
Thank you.
Your research in the past four decades focused on near-death experiences, but also on the after effects and the implications for all of us. You've designed, you supervised, and personally carried out numerous of studies. For example, you developed the near-death experience scale.
Yes.
Which I would say is a research tool. It's essentially a questionnaire, but it allows you and your fellow researchers to differentiate between near-death experiences and other brain conditions.
Right.
And it allows you, I understand, to collect the same relevant information and data so that you can compare it.
Exactly.
So this scale has been translated into 20 languages and it has been used in hundreds of studies.
Yes.
You've published over 100 scholarly articles and you've presented on very many international conferences. I counted 97 presentations on your bio at the DOPS website. I would like to talk to you about your latest book, After.
Sure.
A Doctor Explores What Near-Death Experiences Reveal About Life and Beyond, which you've written for the general public.
Yes.
Now, one of the things I really liked about your book is that you tell us quite a bit about yourself. You talk about your background, you talk about your father who was a scientist too and how that influenced you, the challenges in your career, your thinking. So can you take us back to the beginning and tell us what triggered your interest in near-death experiences?
Sure, sure. Well, as you mentioned, I was raised in a scientific household. My father was a chemist, and our family just had no religious or spiritual traditions. So we grew up in a material world, and what you see is what you get. And as far as I knew, there was nothing beyond the physical. But I was trained to answer all questions by collecting data. And when the data conflict with what you believe, then you go with the data and change your beliefs. My father also taught me that if you study things we already know pretty well, you can make small increments in our knowledge, pushing the decimal points. But if you really want to make progress in science, you have to study things we don't understand. So I went through college and medical school with that materialistic mindset that we would find all the answers to the universe through physical experimentation. And then when I started my psychiatric training, in the first weeks of my training, I was asked to see a patient who had overdosed, and she was down in the emergency room. And I was in the hospital cafeteria at the time, eating dinner, when the pager came off on my belt, and it sounded a loud noise, and it scared me. So I dropped my fork and spilled some spaghetti sauce on my tie. I tried to wipe it off, and I couldn't. So I just put on a white lab coat to cover it so no one would see it. I was embarrassed. A new intern, I didn't know what I was doing. So I went down to the emergency room to see the patient, and she was completely unconscious. I could not arouse her no matter what I did. But her roommate was waiting down the hall in another room to talk to me. So I went down the hall and talked to the roommate for about 15 minutes about what was going on in the patient's life, what stressor she had, what pills she might have taken. It was a very hot evening in Virginia, which is a very warm place. And back in the 1970s, there was no air conditioning. So I was sweating quite a bit, and I opened up my lab coat to cool myself off, and inadvertently exposed a spot on my tie for about 10 minutes. I finished talking to the roommate and got up to say goodbye to her and realized my tie was exposed, so I quickly buttoned it up again. And then went back to see the patient, and she was still unconscious, could not be aroused. So I arranged for her to be admitted to the intensive care unit overnight. And I went back to see her the next morning after she had awoken, and she was very drowsy. She could barely open her eyes. I started to introduce myself, and she stopped me and said, "I know who you are. I remember you from last night." Well, that surprised me. So I said to her, "I thought you were unconscious when I talked to you last night." And she said, opened her eyes then and said to me, "Not in my room. I saw you talking to my roommate down the hall." Well, that just totally blew me away. I couldn't imagine what she was talking about. The only way that could have happened is she had left her body and followed me down the hall. And as far as I knew, I was my body. How can you leave it? She saw my confusion and then started to tell me about the conversation I had with her roommate, all my questions and the roommate's answers, where we were sitting. And finally, she told me about the stain on my tie. And I just could not make any sense of that. I was totally confused. I was actually frightened. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't deal with my confusion. I was there to deal with hers. So I kind of stuffed my feelings away and tried to deal with her and help her with her suicidal thoughts. And I kept pushing those feelings away for about 5 or 6 years until one of my colleagues at the University of Virginia, Raymond Moody, wrote a book called Life After Life, in which he gave us the term near-death experience and described what these things were. And that was my first inkling that this story the patient told me years earlier was not just one story from a psychiatric patient, but was part of a huge phenomenon. I still couldn't understand it, but that meant to me as a scientist, I need to study this and try to understand it. So I started collecting other examples of near-death experiences, trying to find patterns and make sense out of them. And here I am 50 years later, still trying to make sense out of them.
Before we get more into the specifics, would you be able to give us an overview or a summary about the last 40 years of your research and your work? And what are the most important results or lessons that you've mm-hmm. taken away from that?
Sure. Well, the most surprising thing to me at first was how common near-death experiences are. You know, studies of people who have cardiac arrest show that about between 10 and 20% of them will have a near-death experience. And that interprets to about 1 out of 20 people in the general population, 5% of the general population, which means that someone in your family or in your workplace or in your classroom has probably had a near-death experience. The second thing that I learned was that these have nothing to do with mental illness. These are normal experiences that happen to normal people under abnormal conditions. We've looked, and I looked as a psychiatrist, at various ways of the connection between mental illness and near-death experiences. And frankly, there is none. So these are not abnormal experiences, they're normal experiences. Then there are consistent patterns, consistent features that we see across cultures that are independent of religious beliefs or cultural background. And in fact, if you go back through the literature, back to ancient Greece and Rome, you see accounts of near-death experiences that sound just like the ones we hear today. Mm-hmm. And finally, the most important thing to me as a psychiatrist is that these experiences dramatically change people's lives. They change their attitudes, beliefs, values, lifestyle. I don't know of anything that's as powerful as the near-death experience in bringing about these changes.
I might as well pick you up on that one because I'm interested to hear those profound after effects. I read some of the stories. I remember the policeman. I remember the soldier or the ambitious business people. Can you expand a little bit on the profound effects that the near-death experiences have on people?
Sure. Generally speaking, they make people much more spiritual and much less involved with worldly things. And by that, I mean they become much more aware of the interconnection among people. They feel more connected to other people, to the natural world, to the universe, to the divine. And they feel, because of that, a deep compassion for other people. And that leads them to be much more altruistic and much more caring towards other people. They also become less invested in worldly things, which includes material possessions, but also power, prestige, fame, achievements, reputation. These things don't matter as much to them anymore. And these may sound like good changes, but they can actually be very difficult for people whose lives were not particularly spiritual beforehand. And one of the most dramatic examples are people who lead a violent life, who are either career police officers or military officers, whose job requires them to kill people. And after a near-death experience, they often find they cannot go back to that life. And they have to leave that lifestyle and often end up going into a helping profession, healthcare or social work or teaching or the clergy, something like that. It can cause great disruptions in families, in marriages, if one person suddenly has this tremendous conversion and the other one doesn't. Furthermore, we see people who are in very competitive business positions who return from a near-death experience feeling that getting ahead at someone else's expense is pointless, that we're all in this together, and they can no longer go back to that highly competitive situation. And if they do go back to their positions, they become much more compassionate in how they treat their rivals, their employees, and their customers. So it really changes their lives.
You mentioned earlier not the cultural differences, or are there cultural differences in NDEs, say, between United States and Europe or Asia, or even, you know, pre-early civilizations and cultures?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question, because if you look at just the raw data that people report around the world and going back through the centuries, the phenomena they report are the same. However, the way they describe them will be influenced by their cultural or religious background. Most near-death experiencers say that there are no words to describe what they went through. And so they resort to using metaphors to describe what happened to them the best they can. They say that my brain can't understand what I went through, so I'll just use whatever my brain can come up with. And those are often cultural or religious metaphors. For example, people all over the world will talk about encountering a warm, loving being of light. And people in a monotheistic religion like Christianity or Judaism or Islam may call this God or Allah, whereas people in a non-theistic religion like Hinduism or Buddhism will not use those terms. And even Christians will often say to me, I'm going to call this God so you know what I'm talking about, but it wasn't the God I was taught about in church. It was much bigger than that. So the cultural background will influence how they interpret what they went through. Another example is that Westerners will occasionally encounter a black void in which they find themselves just raw consciousness and nothing else, no sound, no vision, and they feel like they're going to be in this state for eternity. And that is quite frightening for most Westerners. However, I've talked to people who were raised in a Hindu culture who experienced the same thing and feel this was blissful, this was nirvana, and they are quite comfortable with that. So it's the same phenomenon, but interpreted differently based on your cultural background.
I want to slot in a more personal question. How difficult did you find it to overcome, I say, the resistance or the lack of interest in the scientific, your fellow scientists, the medical world, or the public at large?
Yeah. Well, I've seen a great change in the 50 years I've been doing this work. When we first started talking about these experiences in medical conferences back in the early 1980s, there would be polite silences and occasional skeptic comments, but no one really knew what we were talking about. And now they are so common and so widely known that when we talked to a medical conference about near-death experiences, it's rare that someone in the audience, a physician, doesn't stand up and say, let me tell you about my experience now. So I think, you know, most doctors know that these things happen to a large number of their patients and they affect the patient's lives. And therefore they want to know about them. So they're very receptive to information about NDEs, near-death experiences. They may still have some very legitimate questions about what causes them, what their ultimate meaning is, but they usually accept that these are real experiences people are having with real consequences.
I want to talk to you about what I think is one of the most fascinating or mind-boggling aspect of the near-death experiences, which is the out-of-body experience.
Yes.
We all know the stories about somebody floating on the ceiling, watching what's happening on the operating table, or hovering over the site of an accident where they've just been involved with. How difficult is it to get proof that these observations of experiences, their perceptions, are actually accurate? Like the one with your tie and the spaghetti stain on your own tie.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, I don't, looking back on it, put much credence in that spaghetti stain story, because I didn't know what I was doing at that point. I didn't know to ask her about other features of a near-death experience. So I don't really put much credence in that one. But I've talked to many people since then who describe very unusual things that they saw while they were out of their bodies, things they couldn't have expected, and that I've been able to corroborate. Let me give you an example. One 55-year-old man I knew who was a truck driver had sudden chest pains as he was driving one day, and he drove immediately to an emergency room. And on evaluation, he was found to have four vessels to his heart partially blocked. So he was taken to the operating room for a quadruple bypass surgery. And during that operation, he later told me, he left his body and rose up above it and looked down on the operating table. And he saw his chest opened up, and he saw the surgeon flapping his elbows like he was trying to fly. Now, at this point, I had been a doctor for about 30 years. I had never seen or heard anything so ridiculous in my life. You don't see doctors on television doing things like this. So I assumed that he was hallucinating. This couldn't possibly be true, but he insisted it was. So several days after his operation, with his permission, I went to talk to his surgeon. And his surgeon, who was a very serious fellow, reluctantly told me, yes, it's true. I developed this habit I've never seen anyone else do. I let my assistants start the procedure while I get my sterile gowns and gloves on. And then I walk into the operating room and watch them for a while. I supervise them. I don't want to risk touching anything that's not sterile. So I put my hands where I know they won't touch anything, flat on my chest. And then I point things out to my assistants using my elbows so I don't touch anything with my hands. And he demonstrated, just like the patient did. This is not something the patient could have guessed was likely to happen, and yet he did. And we have many, many of these cases. Jan Holden at the University of North Texas actually looked at around 100 cases of people who reported being out of their bodies and had potentially verifiable details in them. And what she found was that in 92% of them, independent witnesses said that the reports were completely accurate. So we're not talking about a rare out-of-body experience. These are common experiences that are very frequently corroborated by third parties.
I read that you and other researchers were involved trying to get proof, for example, in the acute hospital setting where people are having a cardiac arrest and being resuscitated and putting up signs somewhere on the shelf so that the person in their out-of-body state would see the sign. And I gather that didn't go so well.
It did not. There have been, I believe, six studies published like this. One that I did with people who were having defibrillators implanted in their chest, so we knew exactly when they were going to have their heart stopped for this procedure. And out of 100 sequential procedures, not a single person had any memory at all. The largest study was one done by Sam Parnia at New York University, actually at several universities. And he studied a total of about 2,000 people who had cardiac arrests in the hospital. And he had placed targets in the corner of the room facing upwards, so you can only see them looking down from the ceiling. And of those 2,000 people, there were 9 who reported some memory that sounded at least vaguely like a near-death experience. And only 2 reported actually being able to see from an out-of-body perspective. And neither one happened to be in a room that had a target placed in it. So this is the way the studies have gone. They're very labor intensive. and they don't produce many results. When I talk to near-death experiences about this study, they just laugh. They say, if you're out of your body for the first time in a medical crisis, are you going to look around that room for some target you didn't even know was there that has no meaning to you and try to remember that so the researcher can ask you later on? So unfortunately, I think we're not going to get proof from those studies.
The other thing I found fascinating is meeting deceased people.
Yes.
And not just people who the experiencer knows that they've died, but also people who they couldn't have known that they had died.
Yeah.
And you give several impressive examples in your book.
Yes. Yeah. About a third of all people who have a near-death experience report encountering a deceased loved one. And those can easily be dismissed by debunkers by saying that this is expectation, you wishful thinking. Mm-hmm. You thought you were dying, and of course you wanted to have your mother come visit you or welcome you, so you imagine seeing her. But there are, as you mentioned, a number of cases of people who encountered someone that they had not known had died. And about more than 10 years ago, I published a paper about this that cited about 30 such cases. And they go back to the first century. Pliny the Elder wrote about a case of a Roman nobleman who had an experience like that. But the one that I was involved with was a 25-year-old fellow who was admitted to the hospital with severe pneumonia, and he had recurrent respiratory arrest where he couldn't get his breath. And he had one primary nurse who worked with him every day who was about his age, and they became friendly over the time he was in the hospital. And one day she told him she was going to take a long weekend off and there'd be other nurses substituting for her. So he wished her well, she went off for the weekend. And while she was gone, he had another respiratory arrest, had to be resuscitated. And during that arrest, he had a near-death experience. And he found himself in a beautiful pastoral scene. And there, to his surprise, this nurse, Anita, came walking towards him. And he did a double take and said, "Anita, what are you doing here?" And she said, "Well, this is where I am now, but you can't stay here. You need to go back to your body. And I want you to find my parents and tell them I'm sorry that I wrecked the red MGB." She then turned and walked away. When he later woke up back in his body in the hospital bed, he tried to tell this to the first nurse who worked into his room, and she got very upset and left quickly. It turned out that his nurse, Anita, had taken the weekend off to celebrate her 21st birthday, and her parents surprised her with the gift of a red MGB. She got excited, climbed into the car, took off for a drive, crashed into a telephone pole, and died instantly, shortly before he had his near-death experience. Now, there's no way he could have known that this 21-year-old girl had died, and certainly no way he could have known how she died, and yet he did. And like I said, we have many examples of this type of experience where people encounter someone that they did not know had died, so it can't be dismissed as expectation.
I'm tempted to ask you right now, how do we explain that? But perhaps we'll defer that, because I wanted to ask you in general about the theories of how we explain near-death experiences.
Yes.
You go through them in, I think in chapter 9 of your book, you list the most important theories, such as lack of oxygen, changes in chemicals, expectations. Can you take us through the most important of those and what you think about them in terms of how good they explain near-death experience?
Yeah, as I mentioned, I started off this research as a skeptic. A skeptic, by the way, is not someone who disbelieves. It's someone who withholds belief until he has all the data. Mm. So many people who call themselves skeptics are not at all skeptics. They're confirmed materialists. But I was a true skeptic, I believe. I was kind of withholding my beliefs. And I approached near-death experiences from a materialistic mindset, thinking there must be some physical explanation for this. And the most obvious one was lack of oxygen, because no matter how you come close to death, lack of oxygen is one of the final common pathways for almost everyone. But there have now been several studies done in the US, in the UK, and in Europe, especially in Holland, where people have measured the oxygenation of people who are coming close to death. And what they find is that those people who report near-death experiences actually have a better oxygen supply to the brain than those who don't report near-death experiences. Now, that doesn't really mean that a better oxygen supply makes it more likely you're going to have a near-death experience. It may just mean you're more likely to remember it later on. But clearly, lack of oxygen is not causing near-death experiences. It's reducing their possibility. And the same is true of drugs given to patients. We find that the more drugs people are given as they're approaching death, the less likely they are to report a near-death experience. There were also hypotheses that some chemical produced in the brain under stress may be contributing to near-death experiences, particularly endorphins, but there have been maybe a dozen different chemicals that have been proposed. The problem with those hypotheses is that they're virtually impossible to test as we can, according to what we can do now. These chemicals are usually produced in very minute accounts for very brief periods of time, and we don't even know where to look in the brain for them. So it's virtually impossible during a near-death event to go into someone's brain and try to draw some fluid out to sample the chemicals. So we really don't know about those. But there have been other theories about the temporal lobe being involved, about a burst of electricity at the time of death, about rapid eye movement intrusion into the near-death state. And we've been able to test most of those and found that there's no evidence for them, or at best, there's inconclusive evidence with some strong evidence against them.
Is it true that some of the near-death experiences have happened during a state where it was fairly certain or sure that the brain couldn't have generated these experiences through normal means because the patient was either too ill or in too deep of a coma, or the brain simply wasn't functioning because there's not enough blood supply to the brain, or right, lack of brain activity? How is the situation there?
Yeah. Well, most of the near-death experiences that have been studied well have occurred during cardiac arrest. And we know that in cardiac arrest, within a matter of seconds, the brain starts being deprived of oxygen and the brain waves start to change. And within about 20 seconds, they may go completely flat, showing virtually no activity in the cerebral cortex, the part of the brain that's easy to measure and that is responsible for complex thinking. That's also true of deep anesthesia, which is true of most operations that we have near-death experiences from. The purpose of anesthesia is to stop you from having these complex thoughts, and they work quite well. So I would say that the vast majority of near-death experiences that would have been studied involve situations where the brain is not capable of producing the complex perceptions and memories and cognitions that you see in near-death experiences. Now, unfortunately, we can't really measure the brain waves while someone is having a near-death experience. It takes about a half an hour to put the electrodes on someone's head, and you can't really do that when someone is in a crisis. There are occasional cases, very rare, in which someone is already having their brainwaves measured when they happen to have a near-death experience. And so they have shown that even when there is a flat EEG, when there's no measurable electrical activity in the brain, people still have very vivid and verifiable perceptions.
In your book, in chapter 10, you talk about Dr. Evan Alexander's case. And we spoke with him on Thanatos here. I actually interviewed him. And shortly before the interview, I was made aware of some of the criticisms that was leveled against him. And I didn't take the opportunity to ask him and give him the opportunity to respond to that. So I wondered if you would mind to tell us your view on the veracity of his story. I know you've been involved. I know it's obviously in one of your chapters in your book, and you even reviewed the medical records.
Yes, yes. Well, one of the complaints lodged against him by his critics is that he had several malpractice suits filed against him And they concluded that he was a liar because he wasn't being honest about those. In matter of fact, Evan Alexander was a neurosurgeon, and the neurosurgeons have one of the highest rates of malpractice suits of any medical specialty. It's rare to find a neurosurgeon who doesn't have several malpractice suits filed against him. So that is not something you can really hold against him. But the more telling issues were that people claimed that he wasn't really near death, that what he said was a coma was actually medically induced by drugs that were given him because he was so agitated to calm him down. Now, you know, being a skeptic, I wasn't about to take his word at face value, but I also wasn't willing to take the skeptic's words at face value. So I, with his permission, got his hospital to send me his medical record, which is more than 600 pages long. And I made copies, and I evaluated one copy, and two other doctors independently evaluated the other two copies. And what we found, all three of us independently, was that he was indeed in a near-death state. He went into a deep coma before he was given any medications. And in fact, he came out of the coma while he was still having those medications. So the medications were not related to his coma at all. Furthermore, sequential CAT scans, computerized axial tomography of his brain, showed that his skull looked like it was filled with mush. You couldn't make out any structure of the brain at all. And it seemed impossible for him to have complex thinking and perceptions while he was in that state. His doctors gave him a 1% chance of survival, and they didn't expect him to be able to function at all if he did manage to survive. And yet—
Did they write that down?
That appears in the medical records.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In fact, they did not even bother to measure his brain waves because they assumed he was a dead man and there's nothing they could do to help him. So they just kind of kept him alive by feeding him through IV tubes. And then after 6 days, to their surprise, he woke up. And it took him a while to get back his memories and his verbal abilities. But he remembered vividly this near-death experience, which has some verifiable aspects. He was able to remember looking down on his hospital room and seeing certain things that occurred at certain days during his hospitalization, and we can verify which days they occurred. And when you look at the medical records, you see there are measures of his depth of coma, the Glasgow coma scale done by every nursing shift, and he showed very severe brain damage at the time when he was having these accurate perceptions.
Thank you for that. I also want to talk to you about the mind and the brain.
Yes.
Obviously, there's the conventional view that the brain produces consciousness, the mind, our thoughts, our perceptions, literally our consciousness, everything. And then there are other ideas, I think more of a dualistic, for example, where the mind or consciousness, I would call it soul, is separate from the physical brain. And we don't quite know how the two work together.
Right.
What's your take on that issue?
Well, yeah, I was trained, as most doctors were, to believe that the mind is what the brain does and that all our thoughts and perceptions are created by the brain. The more I studied near-death experiences, the less that model made sense. It just did not explain what was happening because there were times when the brain seemed to be offline or at least severely compromised, when consciousness, our thinking and our feeling and our perceptions were more vivid than ever. That just did not make sense if the brain is creating all our thoughts and feelings and perceptions. So I tend to think that there is some dualistic process going on here where there is a separate part of us that thinks and feels. You can call it the mind, you can call it the soul, whatever you want to call it, that's separate from the brain. This is not a new idea. It goes back to Hippocrates 2000 years ago, who wrote that the brain is the messenger or the interpreter of the mind. And I think one of the models that's often used now is the idea that the mind is out there somewhere, and the brain's job is to filter the mind. much the way a radio tuner filters out radio waves. There are thousands of radio stations out there. If you tried to listen to all of them at once, you wouldn't be able to understand any of it. So the radio tuner selects one particular station that you want to listen to and filters out all the rest. And the idea is that the brain does that also. The brain is an organ like every other organ in our body that evolved to help us survive in the physical world. So the brain filters out those cognitive contents of our mind that are not relevant to survival, things like seeing deceased loved ones and communicating with the divine. You don't need those to find food and shelter and a mate. So it filters those ideas out and just lets in those thoughts that are relevant to survival. That's not surprising. Our eyes do that. Our ears do that. They just let in those stimuli that are essential to our survival. We don't see all the electromagnetic spectrum. We don't hear all the frequencies, just those that are important to surviving. And then when you are in a compromised state and your brain is failing, that filtering function gets lost or gets weakened. And all these other contents of our mind come flooding in, like seeing deceased loved ones and functioning outside the body. The near-death experience is one example of the mind functioning when the brain is not, but it's not the only one. Another example is terminal lucidity, in which people who have end-stage dementia, such as Alzheimer's disease, suddenly become completely lucid again after they've been unable to recognize family or communicate for months or sometimes years, shortly before they die. And there's no medical explanation for this. One theory is that this is the brain's filtering stopping so that the mind can then function again. Now, as you mentioned, this raises the question of how this non-physical mind interacts with the physical brain. And I have no idea how that could happen. On the other hand, if you believe the conventional model that the brain creates the mind, we have no idea how that could happen. No one has ever come up with an idea of how a chemical or electrical process in the brain can create a thought or a feeling.
So on this issue of survival of consciousness, what would you say does the near-death experience, the research in this field, what can it tell us about perhaps our hopes, our questions, whether we actually survive physical death?
Well, that's the ultimate question, isn't it?
The ultimate, yeah.
If the mind can function without the brain while you're alive, that opens the possibility of whether it might be able to function after you die. And there is certainly evidence for that in the near-death experience. And primary among that is the encounters with deceased loved ones, particularly those who you did not know had died, which suggests that they still survive after death in some form that can communicate with us. How long can they survive? Is it an hour, 10 hours, 10 days? We don't know. But certainly some people claim to encounter deceased loved ones who have been dead for years or decades. So we don't know the answer to that question, but there certainly are suggestions from near-death experiences that death is not the end of us. And furthermore, that what happens after death is not something to be terrified of. Almost every single near-death experiencer returns from the experience saying that they are no longer afraid of death, that no matter what they thought of death beforehand, they are no longer afraid of it. And that's a pretty profound and widespread change.
And paradoxically, those who committed suicide aren't afraid of death either, but decided it's not such a good idea.
That's right. That's right. I had worked with a lot of suicidal patients in my career. And I knew a lot of them who had been contemplating suicide, but were deterred because they were afraid what might happen after they die. And I thought, well, if they find out that nothing bad happens, they're going to be more suicidal. In fact, they are not. We did a study of every patient who was admitted to the hospital with a suicide attempt. And we compared those who had a near-death experience as a result of that attempt with those who didn't have an NDE. And those who had a near-death experience became much less suicidal. That seemed counterintuitive to me. So I asked them to explain that to me. And what they said was that they now see, because of the NDE, meaning and purpose in their lives that they didn't see before. So even if they had the same problems that led them to commit suicide, they no longer saw those problems as something to be run away from, but as challenges to learn from. And they found life much more meaningful and fulfilling after the near-death experience than they did before.
So with all the knowledge that we've accumulated, and not just from near-death experiences, but also from perhaps related fields like parapsychology and other areas, haven't we got enough, accumulate enough knowledge to conclude actually that consciousness does survive physical death, that the mind, you call it, or the soul continues, it retains its personality, its individuality, memory, of course, even seems to have a familiar appearance, because otherwise how would they recognize people who have been deceased? Isn't this knowledge enough to conclude this view?
Well, you know, as a scientist, I'm reluctant to say we have proof of anything. You know, throughout the centuries, we've always looked back on previous generations and said, how can they be so gullible to believe what they did? And I'm sure that 100 years from now, they'll look back on us and say, how can we have been so gullible? So I would say that the evidence certainly points towards survival after death. But I don't think I would say that it's 100% conclusive. We may be misinterpreting some of the evidence. There may be more evidence that comes up in the next 50 years that'll contradict what we know. But it certainly seems that to be the case that we do survive. As to how we survive, I'm not so sure about that. Because as most near-death experiencers say, they can't put into words what they actually experienced. And when they see someone that they identify as a deceased loved one, they may describe it. They may describe that person as being visually the same. But there are some who don't, who say, it was a ball of light that I recognized as my mother. I said, well, how do you know it was your mother? Well, it felt like her. It had her sense. So people kind of put onto this perception whatever they needed to identify it. And in fact, when they see deceased loved ones, they don't see them as they were when they died. They see them as they were in the prime of life. So it may be that we, the experiencers, are superimposing on the experience what we need to identify that person.
So after 40 years of trying to answer these questions, what personal worldview have you derived at? Do you believe in life after death, or how do you see?
You know, I think the biggest change in me is that I am now very comfortable with not knowing the answers, which would have shocked me 50 years ago to say something like that. But I've seen so many things I can't understand that I'm convinced are real, that I kind of believe what most near-death experiencers say, that our brains just can't comprehend what's really out there. And what happens after death is something that's so far beyond our imagination that I expect to be very surprised when I get there.
What are the most important open questions in this field of near-death research?
Well, I think that the biggest question is the ultimate meaning or the ultimate origin of them. Do we really have a soul or a spirit that survives us, that's not physical, that survives the physical body? I think the evidence is pointing in that direction, but I don't think it's conclusive yet. I think the moral implications of that is a big question. Most near-death experiences, as I said, come back with a sense that we are not alone in this world. They talk about people being like fingers on a hand. If you look at the fingers, they look like individual entities. But if you look at the whole hand, you see they're really interconnected. And they see that as justifying the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, which is a part of every religion we have on earth. And they say that it's not just a guideline. This is the way the universe works. You can't hurt someone without hurting yourself. And conversely, you can't help someone without helping yourself as well. So they come back being much more compassionate towards other people. And that leads them to a much more meaningful and fulfilling life. I think that many near-death experiences talk about, as an analogy, a wave in the ocean, and that we during this life are a wave that's composed of the same material the rest of the ocean is. And eventually we will melt back into the ocean and cease to be an individual wave. And I think that's an attractive metaphor for what may happen to us after death, that we may just sort of melt into this greater, whatever it is, consciousness, Godhead, ocean, and become with it while still retaining some of the properties of the individual wave, some personality aspects.
So what will you be doing in the future, in the next few years, in terms of research?
That's a great question. As a psychiatrist, I'm still focused mostly on how these experiences affect people. And I'm starting to turn my attention now to people who have difficulty returning to a, quote, normal life after a near-death experience and seeing what kinds of problems they are facing and how they think we can go about helping them deal with these issues. Mm-hmm. So we're surveying near-death experiences who had trouble and also counselors of different types who help these near-death experiences to try to see what seems to be the most helpful techniques in working with people who have difficulty readjusting to a physical life after a near-death experience.
What kind of challenges do they face?
Well, some of it is ridicule or labeling. People call them crazy. Some are within yourself, how you come to terms with this experience, how you reconcile your new attitudes and beliefs with your lifestyle. And some are interpersonal within your family. When you have a sudden change in belief system and your wife or your husband or your parents don't, how do you resolve those problems? How do your differences in values now change with what you think is important doing in life? Your career, your hobbies, your volunteering.
And you're still involved with the university and the Department of Perceptual Studies?
Yes, I am. Yes, I am officially retired, which means they no longer pay me for doing it. But I'm still very much involved with doing research and teaching and supervising more junior colleagues who are doing research.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dr. Greyson, thank you so much for your experiences, your insights. It's been really fascinating and thought-provoking. I do hope that your book gets translated into many more languages and a lot of people will read it.
Thank you. Well, thank you for this opportunity.
Yes, thank you so much for talking to us.
Yes.
Thank you.